is not a game. This is a job interview from hell.
From all corners of the country, 16 people have come to London.
I don't care where you come from, whether you started in a council flat or born with a silver spoon in your mouth. All I'm looking for is somebody who is drop-dead true.
They're here to compete for a job worth £100,000. With a man famously hard to please.
No one's gonna make a fool out of me.
Sir Alan Sugar has built a global business empire worth £800 million. Now, once again, he's on the hunt for an apprentice.
I think this has been a bloody disaster. And I promise you, my friend, you would be out that door so quick, you wouldn't know what's hit you.
To succeed, they're going to have to live...
This is the life.
...and work together.
We are going to make some money.
We really are.
I am your boss.
No, you're not my boss. You're a project manager.
Your boss.
You're nothing to me.
It's the chance of a lifetime.
You went out and lost me money. You're fired. You're fired. You are a total shambles. You're fired.
Previously on The Apprentice.
Today, it's not going to be a task. It's going to be a grueling interview process. Three of you are going to get fired.
The candidates faced a grilling from Sir Alan's most trusted associates. Some candidates stood out.
I'm relentless. There's no way that anybody can ever say to me you can't do something, because if they do, I'll turn around and prove to them that I can.
I know Amstrad's sales were 100 million in the last financial year, and I know that their write-downs were 5.7 million.
Right, you know.
I've done my research properly.
Others were on shaky ground.
You didn't Google Alan?
No, I didn't.
Do you think you should have done?
I probably should have, yeah.
Okay, well then...
You know, when you run a company, you're out there in the big, bad world of business.
Sure.
And they'll cut your fucking legs off to make a few quid.
So. I earn 90k a year. I work for a global business consultancy. I've got a gold card for BA.
I don't really understand why you're here.
In the boardroom, it came down to three. And Sir Alan questioned Katie's commitment.
My guys, they think you have the capability, but they said they don't know what you're doing here. It would really, really annoy me if you took the opportunity away from someone else.
I think it's more important to get my plans in place first. And therefore, I suggest I stand down.
What you saw there was someone who couldn't give me the commitment I needed, the commitment that I know that you're going to give me. You're in the finals.
Now, two remain to fight for the chance to become The Apprentice. Weeks ago, 16 candidates entered this house. Two have survived.
So how many tasks did you win overall, Christina?
I won five, and therefore I lost five. In fact, I beat you already. Just
Why?
Remember that. Well, I beat the term that you lost as a PM.
You were.
I was PM, and I beat you.
You beat me. So I'm.
Are you scared?
I owe you one. That's you're spurring me on. Keep talking.
It's my dream to win The Apprentice. I would love to win the competition. I would absolutely love it. I would love a chance to work with Sir Alan.
Do you feel scared?
No, not at all.
You should do.
I thought you were a walkover this time.
I am going to win The Apprentice. I haven't come here to be second or third or whatever. I've come here to win.
You're giving me an extra reason to beat you.
But yeah, I feel confident.
Nah, I don't you start talking like that. All right? You want me to get nasty, I can get nasty.
No, okay?
Next day, Simon and Christina are summoned to the boardroom. And this time, they're travelling business class. At the end of this week, one will be Sir Alan's apprentice, with a six-figure salary.
I think I'll be the next apprentice.
I think Christina's a great girl, but I think in terms of what Sir Ellen might be looking for, I'd probably fit the bill a bit better.
A lot of the time, you know, even if people don't particularly like what I say, I gain respect from the team that I work with, and I don't think Simon gets the respect.
Good morning.
Morning, sir.
Well, congratulations. From over 10,000 applicants, we're down to you, final two. But you've got a very big hurdle to overcome. OK. Your task is all about coming up with a landmark for London. I'm going to show you a video. See that building there in the middle? I recently bought that for £120 million. What I'm looking for is some conceptual ideas for what you're going to replace it with. A meaningful, innovative building. And of course, it's got to make me some money. Okay. This is a massive task. You've got no time to lose. Good luck. Off you go.
Sir Alan's property is a real site in a real place. Nothing will get built. He just wants to use it to test Simon and Christina's creativity.
I used to have a Lego set and I used to dream about building things when I was younger. When I was a child, I wanted to be a builder.
If you look at the whole thing in total, you think, oh, my God, you know, what, where do I start?
In 4 days' time, they'll present their vision to Sir Alan's invited audience of top property executives in Old Billingsgate Market, now refurbished as a premier London venue.
Quite clearly, this is conceptual. This is not a real planning application because such a thing takes up to 5 years and one has to consult with various agencies and departments. What I'm out to do is to see how they organise themselves, how they can run a team of people, how creative they are.
At the house, their teams, eight of the candidates already fired by Sir Alan, are back.
Oh, you'll recognise some old friends.
Yeah. How you doing, everybody?
Oh, my goodness!
To help them, Christina and Simon must pick four each.
Right, well, which one would you choose most? Out of everybody that
Trey,
you've chosen?
Trey's my Trey. Boy, obviously. Okay,
if I allow you to have Trey.
Yeah, if you allow me to have Trey.
I can have Naomi, yeah?
All right.
So, nay Trey.
Christina picks Naomi, Adam, Natalie and Paul. Simon picks Lohit, Jadine, Trey and Rory.
Looking good with the haircut?
But Rory and Trey have some history.
None of this back chat and the rest of it in front of everyone else, right? Enough.
Stop talking to me. I'm going to stop talking to you. Don't wind me up.
I'd just like you to do as you're told.
Guys. It's good to have everybody back together.
Whee! Pivo greets you.
Here's to a victory, guys. Okay.
Yay. 8:30 a.m. Simon and his new team tour Sir Alan's latest purchase. They must come up with a replacement to this 25-year-old building. Already, Simon and Trey are inspired.
I'll just let you know what Trey and I have just been thinking of initially. The idea that we come together within the space of 5 minutes, we thought about having like a boat-type structure, big glass walls, to maximise the fact that it's quite a narrow front, but a long you know, obviously.
But when you say boat, don't kind of think, oh my God, it's a land-based ship. Nothing like that.
There is an ark
like
in Hammersmith. I think
yes, there is. There is. Yeah. There is an ark in Hammersmith.
There has to be.
Something has to be something in nature.
Yeah. So let's go and do the research first.
See you later on. Bye.
All right. Listen. About the hot boat thing, keep all your ideas a little bit curbed right now, because otherwise they're going to think that, you know, we're going to know what people are like.
Looks rather as if he split the team into the A team and the B team. And the B team have gone sort of drifting off, thinking about design sort of ideas. And Trey and Simon have already got an idea about a building that looks like a ship and has a luxury hotel in it.
11 a.m. Leaving the rest of his team behind, Simon takes Trey off to work on their boat idea.
I think Trey's one man, you know, is worth three men alone in terms of ideas, creativity, energy. There's no real need to combine him with anyone else because he doesn't need to...
He's getting a payoff later.
He doesn't need anyone to support him, I don't think.
A bit knocked, really. He's just kind of... They're already scheming, though. I mean, they haven't really done anything yet. There's some bloody great big boat and stuff.
It's just predictable. That's just the way it is with Simon and Trey. It's Simon believes that Trey is his most loyal companion and he doesn't want to offend Trey in any way.
I felt a boat was a bad design because it's just so bloody obvious. We're next to the Thames. It's just sort of kind of the uninspiring thought I would imagine from a chap like Trey. It's just all so naff.
I can see it all kicking off this evening.
Yeah, I'm planning on having a kick-off.
Working for Christina, Naomi and Adam target the Science Museum, hoping to find a futuristic shape for her building.
That, I like that.
Are you seeing a building in that ad?
Yeah. Can you not?
That concept there at the top of the building, right? Down towards the river. In fact, to build it, you can actually buy a space shuttle off the Russians that they don't need anymore and build inside the space shuttle.
I don't think you'd be allowed a nuclear plant on the edge of the Thames.
And then the top part is your building. These are all metal structures that keep it held up.
So we have, like, a hot air balloon on the skyline?
Yeah.
The base could be boxed. And then you
Christina also has Paul. She's discovered the former army officer is a trainee building surveyor and wants to tap in to his expertise.
Yes. Yeah. Peter, you want to build as much square footage as possible and get the most amount of return for that square footage, you know?
Yeah, I agree.
And the most efficient shape to use to get maximising square footage is a box, boringly enough.
Right. OK.
But they haven't always worked well together. Falling out when Christina blew the whistle on Paul's affair with Katie.
It's always him and Katie, and, do you know, half of me wants us to get into the boardroom because I'd nail them. They've got a personal relationship.
Are you telling me they're carrying on in the house?
Yes, they are. If she sits on your lap and you're stroking each other and God knows what, that constitutes a relationship as far as I'm concerned.
That's pretty big. In the back of my mind is the thought, well, she kind of fucks you over in the past and now you're working, you know, as much as you can for her. But at the end of the day, I'm a professional. I've worked with people I've disliked more than Christina and I've done a fucking good job for them in the past.
2 p.m. Convinced their boat concept can work, Simon and Trey visit the London Aquarium to immerse themselves in watery shapes.
By the end of the day, it's going to be nailed. It's going to be absolutely nailed.
We should do this for a living.
Yeah.
It attacks prey twice its size.
Are they piranhas?
Yeah.
God, they look so friendly.
You haven't seen the teeth.
I just really like the way the whole thing looks in terms of the environment. It gives it such an amazingly natural kind of watery thing, isn't it? So much shit in my head that I'm interested in doing. I mean, I practically want to make this thing look like it's floating on water. And I can do that. Then all I've got to do is go back to Rory, Jadine and Lowett and sell it to them, because Simon will go along with it, surely. He's a good boy.
That's a group.
It's amazing how many species live in harmony, isn't it? Whereas humans find the smallest difference to fight about.
The rest of Simon's team is at Kew Gardens, Jadeen and Lohit need a shape to stop Trey's boat idea going ahead.
I think what we should try and do is look for, like, really simple shapes, like maybe close-ups of leaves, grass, any sort of shapes in terms of flowers.
Definitely.
Well, what if the building was shaped like a finger? Mm-hmm. I don't know, like, could you have somehow something pointing into the sky? Is that a little random?
Is that Alice we're going on that?
Wow. Design graduate Rory spots a shape he likes.
Well, I think people will come and see that.
If what Sarah was looking for is a legacy, then this really kind of follows the theme.
And it doesn't look like a boat.
It doesn't. Well done, Rory.
I'd love it if Alan Sugar suddenly turns around and says, gosh, Rory, design-wise, you probably saved this project for Simon. And I'd love to sort of say something like, yeah, well, thanks for fucking seeing this, week 12.
Six p.m. By tomorrow morning, Simon and Christina's teams must have come up with concepts to take to a team of architects. Simon and Trey head back to the house, already thinking up names for their boat building.
Anchor point, anchors, ship, boat, ship's anchor, riverway, south bank, shores, clippers, Britannia.
So when we put the ideas on the tables, boys, what do you think we're here? So here's the ideas we came up with. What will Simon and Trey say?
Yeah. Here's a lovely boat.
What about the floater?
When we say organic and shapes and da-da-da, what do they say?
Yeah. Here's a lovely boat, right?
Back at the house, Christina calls a meeting to discuss her team's concepts.
What I'd really like to see is what Naomi and Adam have done today.
That was the first idea that I had.
Let's have a look closer
now. Now, it's a hot air balloon. Nice. You're just looking at that one. So that what the idea was, if there would actually be steel that would actually hold it up, the majority of the building would be coming out again. We've got the footpaths here, but at quite high sort of level.
Okay, we'll move to the next one.
Adam is sort of a bit out of his depth. And I'm sure that, you know, in the world that he works in, he's great at what he does, but I just don't think he cuts the mustard here intellectually.
Paul, looking at the designs that we've gone through, which ones will work with the space, the type of space we've got?
The best use of that space in terms of purely getting the maximum amount of a usable space there is just to do an oblong building. What we should do is have something visual at the front that fronts onto the river and uses that river view, and then maybe have something a bit more conventional towards the rear of it that is increasing the sort of the market.
Currently, Paul's being given all the attention because he's a surveyor. The only times I've come across surveyors have been when they've come out to value the house and invariably got it completely fucking wrong. So whether he's the most qualified person for a design part of the task right now, I don't know.
Upstairs in the playroom, Simon and Trey try to float their big idea to the rest of the team.
Trey and I talking about today about making sort of a boat shape style design.
More just like a nautical theme as such, to kind of fit in with the river. There's nothing, like you said, that fits in as such. And in terms of water features, you could do loads of water features as such.
Binger, you are not going to be the apprentice with that design. Okay. You've got one chance to do what the hell you like. You
exactly.
It doesn't matter
about anything. You've just got to make something that's bloody marvellous.
Really fucking spunky, really gutsy. This is something people will come and see.
Rory has his own vision, inspired by the organic shapes in Kew Gardens.
And it comes right up like that. It comes back up like that. And there's the final kind of... I mean, work on that sort of shape. This is London design. It is amazing, right? Which is something that people are actually going to come and see. Getting on a plane and coming and seeing. I'm sorry, that is just nothing.
Hey guys, I'll go with the group vote. If you think this design is good and you like it, then let's run with it, certainly.
I wish I'd never bothered coming. It's a complete waste of my time. I came here to help Simon. I don't understand it. I mean, maybe it's me that doesn't understand things properly, but it's just... I just think he's gone way, way, way off track.
I would like to wind Trey up a little bit.
but I don't want to get punched, so I've got to be slightly careful. Although, I know they don't want a straight-up punch fight. He kicked my ass, but there are lots of fire extinguishers around this building, and I have this image of them being wrapped around his head.
Christina has followed Paul's advice for a large oblong, but with angels on both ends.
Is there an issue, do you think, with calling it the angel?
The only problem is you've got angel in London.
In London, isn't it?
As in angel, isn't it?
You've got the angel in the north.
What about Phoenix?
Phoenix.
Ooh, oh,
that's quite good.
Well done.
Oh, I'll tell you, that play, though, incubates ideas.
The Phoenix. Just, you know. From the ashes of Sir Alan's old building.
Indeed. It's almost got a religious quality, hasn't it? So it's almost, and Phoenix risen from the flames, it's kind of like Jesus coming back to life.
Right, okay. That's that done.
Later that evening, with the boat idea finally scrapped, Jadine takes Simon to one side.
It's not their time, Simon, it's your time, yeah? It's either people are here now either to prove something to the rest of the world, or prove something to Sir Alan and all that kind of bullshit.
I don't think Trey's in missing to prove something to the rest of the world.
I don't know, What I do know is that you're in the final. Yeah. That when people get to positions like this, you can get a lot of people around you, Simon, that pretend they have your best interests at heart, and they don't. Mm. Worry about what you're doing, fill your brain with it, consume yourself with it, and make this your best task you've ever done.
OK. All right. Thank you for your effort. You've done very well.
Day two. 48 hours before the presentation to Sir Alan. With their concepts agreed, the teams must now work with experts. Christina has split her team. Paul and Adam are at the architects, hoping to develop a computer visualization of the Phoenix.
It's 30 stories high.
30 stories.
So the main body of the building extends 30 stories, and they were thinking of putting another story on top to sort of create penthouse apartments.
Have you been to Gateshead?
Yeah,
the Angel of the North.
Yeah, I've been and seen that.
People were originally saying sort of angel, but then we sort of went for Phoenix. The idea is, you know, it's sort of regeneration of the area.
The big thing with the Phoenix. That's the main
And we're next door to a theatre, so it's kind of like somebody taking a bow at the end of the
film. It just seems very odd to put these things on the end that really look like the Angel of the North to me. And it's very formalistic in a way. It's, you know, you imagine some of those like Mussolini-type buildings, you know, in the sort of neo-fascist buildings had that sort of, you know, the big eagle, the think of the Nazi eagle. It just has that, I think it has the wrong connotations, really, as an image.
You design something that's going to outlive all of us, yeah? So it's not so much about money. It's more about, is it something that I'm going to be really proud of to show my kids?
Yeah.
And say, like, I did that, it'd be fantastic. So think about that.
So it's back to the drawing board for Adam and Paul.
Kind of casting a shadow down, I mean, you could use different colours, different lighting. So the larger one here is casting a shadow down to the front.
Still at the house, with his team divided, Simon calls an emergency meeting.
Yesterday was a fucking shambles, and I'm not going to put up with it any longer.
There's no incentive for people to work as hard as they could. There is an incentive for me, because it's my fucking job on the line, OK? And that's why I expect people to pull their weight and to not be negative and make catty remarks or sit there with sour faces going, like fucking children. If we win this task, I'm going to take everyone to Barcelona for the weekend, at my expense. That's how much I'm going to win this. So I don't want any more fucking about.
To say to me, I'm going to take you on a holiday with Rory, Jadine and Lowit, is like telling me I'm going to stab you in the eye with a rusted screwdriver. So, as far as incentives go, I've kind of blocked that out of my brain now. My real incentive is just making him win.
11 a.m. Simon has sent Rory's drawings to the architect without Rory.
Right, is this one doable in terms of this was three different buildings, one, two and three, so are you making the full use of the length?
Very good question. I think it would be a good way to go. When we saw these amazing drawings, it was very disappointing for the four of us next door to not have the person that created those drawings with us, because I think that we would have progressed the scheme a lot more rapidly if he'd been around.
It's all right, right? I don't like being a complete fucking snob all the time, but actually, this guy, Trey, is fucking self-taught. Okay, he's self-help. There's nothing there that's disciplined from a design point of view. He can just chat shit for England about how he's this, that and the rest of it. Bottom line, he hasn't got a grounding in design.
My relationship with Trey has always been closely scrutinised. A lot of people have had different opinions about it, whether we're too close, whether I take too much of a lead from him, whether he controls me. But I think with somebody like Trey, you have to let him feel that he's in control. He wants to be top dog. He wants to feel like he's top dog. But it's important for me to remember that I'm the human with the lead.
Can you have, like, buildings curling onto people?
Over the next few hours, the teams and the architects get down to producing computer simulations of the buildings.
So raise one wing so it collects more of the sun and lure the other.
While the finalists search out what sells at the top end of the property market.
Would you go for more residential within that, or would you go 50-50?
60-40, 70-30, residential office split.
At their presentations, Simon and Christina will have to convince Sir Alan that their buildings can make a profit.
If you realise £1,000 per square foot, that means we're selling it for £500,000. That means we're making £400,000 profit.
Yeah.
A deal, I'm done.
Easy money.
To maximise income, Christina's keen to get her percentages right.
Let me just tell you what I've been told, OK, and this will give you an idea, right?
Yeah.
Right, 70% residential.
70% residential.
30% offices.
And at the moment, the residential area is 40% and the retail area is about... Actually, wrong.
You've got residential down as what, 40%?
And offices are about 50% of the total area of the building.
Right, it does need to be changed around.
Christina, the way the building's designed, it's not exactly like it was this morning. The floor goes all the way across. They're in.
Ads, just stop, darling, stop for a second.
No, Christina, you're not listening to me. What I'm saying is it's almost two buildings.
Adam, can you just put Paul on for a second? Because I need to speak to him about something.
Okay, but what we'd do is we'd shift it back to one, we'd change it to one retail floor and we'd change it to 60-40 residential offices.
Are you saying that you've got problems in terms of you being able to do this in the time frame that we've got and that's why you're not doing 70-30, or are you just saying that you'd prefer not to do 70-30?
It's okay, mate, we'll just move the boundary, it's not a problem.
Unsure what her building now looks like, Christina rushes back to have a look.
New building.
Oh, wow.
Okay, so you've raised one of the wings just to sort of give it a more of a flowing feel. And also, I think it improves the look of the building as well. But when he said we need to increase the amount of accommodation, we needed to increase the frontage on the river. We've done that by creating these sort of secondary echoes of the front of the building.
Do I trust Paul? Probably not. But can I manage Paul? Probably yes. And I think that... In a task like this that is business orientated, then as long as I manage him well and as long as I keep an eye on him, then you know I can deal with the trust element of it.
Okay, tell me where my 70-30 comes from.
Okay, so this volume here
is 70%.
64%. It's about 64%.
Right. So what I said to you on the phone, you can't carry through, okay? Because you didn't say that on the phone, did you? When I explained it to you in terms of the brief, but. I'm not going to go down, you know, I'm not going to pipe on about that, but this is not changeable, is it?
I would say this is too late in the day to change.
Right, okay.
This is the best solution. Whatever. This is the best solution.
9 p.m. Simon calls a meeting to discuss presentations. Rory wants to sell the concept to Sir Alan with dancing showgirls.
It is an evening that these guys have come out for, you know, and if there are a certain amount of entertainment that is also relevant to it, then why not? You know, if we just had no dancers and just a sculpture, but come on, snore.
Presentation is all great and well, but what we have to remember, the main thing that we have to wow the people with is the building. Now, if the lighting in the room is too dark and seedy and party-ish, and people don't get to enjoy the pictures, then we're screwed.
To stop. Honestly, if you came up with that idea, most people would run for the hills. You know, architects would go, what you like? Accountants would just...
My speech.
They'd just fry up, their heads would fall off. This is
This is really brave from a potentially a very, very brave man.
I've always had a great interest in women, full stop. And actually, I mean, they are pretty bloody awesome things. And then suggest that suddenly it says, you know, we could have dancing girls. You know, that was like cat got milk. Anyway, so, but obviously, I've got to tone that down, be careful that it's not some sex show.
It's a very, very big development. It's going to be a huge, huge budget. And, you know, why not go for something that's going to potentially blow the socks off? If it works, it'll work really, really well. If it doesn't, I'll look like a pillock.
Next morning, Rory is up early to choreograph the dance. He plans to theme it on the building's name, The Wave.
Are you choreographing the dance?
Yeah.
Do you know anything about dance?
Yeah, yeah, fine. Trust me.
Are you an ex-ballet dancer?
No.
Are you a gymnast?
No.
Can you dance?
I've got an imagination trait. Anyway, so look, the first part is the girls with their things, with these dress things, OK? And they're doing this sort of... They've got these, you know, sort of... Anyway, these dresses go up and it starts very, very gently.
If they're going to cut, are they just flowing straight down or are they coming out?
I'm about to tell you. The bottom of the dress is actually attached to their hands.
Okay? Right, okay.
So what they have is a sort of thing where they move around. So it starts very, very calmly. If you listen to the music as well,
yeah,
it does.
I know the music. Yeah.
And then it gets bigger and bigger and bigger. Now, once these people start doing this big thing here, behind. You start seeing this effect going on.
Right.
Right, so...
So the girls behind don't have their hands tied to their dresses?
We need to see what they... Because I think...
Because you don't want them to have their hands tied to their dresses and then they're trying to rotate ribbons at the same time, because I'm sure some of the guests will appreciate it, but most probably won't. There's no way I'm leaving this whole section to Rory. I cannot risk that whatsoever. Especially with his circular motion that he wants to do. Oh, it's awful.
After breakfast, Trey, Lohit, Rory and Jadeen head off to buy props for the dancers.
These sticks, right, how are they capped off?
They're just like canes.
They're very heavy.
So they're just flat, so straight all like, the way down, right? Do you know how silk works?
It wouldn't.
She's going to swing it, the silk's going to go flying off with a pin. So how the fuck are you going to keep the silk on the stick?
The stick is like that, okay?
Yes.
And you've got...
It's quite thick, and it's wooden.
Yep, yep, that's fine.
All the way down.
And what you're doing is simply taking the end of the material, wrapping it around once, pin.
That's not going to slide off when she swings it?
No, because it's sticking straight in through the silk into the pole.
Why are you all suddenly so interested in this suddenly?
Because we don't trust you to do it. Is that the fucking honest truth,
it's
yeah?
Not happening
it's because you're not doing it right.
Rory, we are a team. When no one's working against you, we are trying to work with you. And what we are trying to make you understand is that we don't have the time.
How was this morning working with
you? If you stop having your fucking hissy fits and acting like a big, silly little bitch.
Hissy fit? You're a fucking bro.
You moron. You're a complete moron. Fucking nuts.
Driving me mad. They don't seem to trust me at all. I didn't fanny around for 7 years setting stuff up. We're asking for silk. This is about the simplest task we've been asked to do, and they all want to get in charge.
Tomorrow, each team will have a room to display plans and models. Christina calls her team together to discuss how to present her building.
You know, we're not going down the tacky route whatsoever. No. Whatever you get from them, it's going to enhance the surroundings, not bring us down a level, okay?
Try and keep it as clean and as tidy and as kind of smart looking as possible, because we don't want a jungle-esque effect, if you know what I mean.
No leopard
skin. No leopard skin.
It's not pantomime, it's class.
Okay, you guys, you happy with what you're doing?
Yep.
Sure. Okay.
Good luck.
See you guys.
See you guys.
Christina sent Natalie and Adam off to get props for their presentation and their room, their theme room. A dangerous choice, I would have thought. Lord knows what they'll bring back.
We just need to keep it really classy.
Yeah, exactly.
And not go overboard and get loads of stuff.
Yeah.
The teams have the rest of the day to prepare for the presentations.
They have a big box in them and they have a roaring flame up to about here.
Finalise their buildings.
That just says wave to you.
Yeah, well, it does if you look at the cross section rather than sort of the three-dimensional angle to it. I think from above it'll look a lot better.
and make the figures add up.
Just lost £53.5 million.
I think you're very sanguine about the whole thing.
Thanks.
No problem.
Because I see the big pot of styling polar bear when I was here a wee while ago. I didn't know whether we could do something Phoenix, you know, in the shape of a Phoenix design.
No, I don't like it. It's too 1930s Germany again.
Is it?
Yeah, I don't like it.
Wow. It is very sexy. That is cool.
Do you know, we were told to give the wow factor, and that does give the wow factor.
Actually, that building looks quite good.
It's bold. No one can say that it's not bold.
No, no one could accuse you of being timid.
Yeah, absolutely.
The morning of the presentation. At 6 this evening, Simon and Christina must present their building designs to Sir Alan Sugar and 100 property experts. At Old Biddingsgate Market, Natalie and Adam put the finishing touches to Christina's exhibit room.
Happy?
Yeah, I am. It's good.
Hey!
You like?
What do you think?
I'm not sure about them.
About the banjo on the back?
Yeah, it's just something not going on there with me.
What, the skyscraper?
Yeah.
Oh, but you love that.
Dear. I just don't see what that...
What they're achieving.
Yeah, what is it that that's achieving? I felt like as if I'd arrived in a brothel or something like that, and, you know, some can-can girls were going to jump out from behind the buildings or something, but it was just bulky. It's cheap-looking. You know, there's nothing cheap about this building, and that's why I didn't want, what you know, these kind of silly props.
I think
the decision is, they go.
Take them down. Come on, then, let's take them down.
To be quite honest, I'm not feeling much like I've been motivated to help her win a £100,000 a year job. Right now, I couldn't give a toss if she wins or Simon wins, to be quite honest.
On Simon's team, Rory's dancers have arrived.
But don't try to choreograph it and direct it as such. Just give them an idea and an inspiration and a kind of direction.
Is it getting motion now? Okay, so what we'll do. And it gets faster and faster and faster. The music's getting wilder and wilder and wilder.
Fix this fucking dance, please.
Say again? What's happening? It was quite nice outside. Let me just...
Well, he's trying to get me to do all sorts of funny shit with this stuff, and it's not looking right.
Have we got sticks? Did they bring sticks?
Give them creative rein. They're dancers. Just tell them what
exactly.
You're looking for and let them do it. He really wants it to be a certain way.
It's wholesome.
But you've got to let them do what they're naturally good at. Otherwise, you might as well just have hired monkeys off the street to swing these things around.
Girls at the front are going absolutely... And then suddenly, you know, there's the big boom.
Six p.m. As 100 hard-nosed property people arrive at Old Biddingsgate, it's almost time for the finalists to take the wraps off 72 hours of non-stop creativity. At stake, just one job. Sir Alan is about to find out who has delivered and who has not.
Good luck, everyone. Good luck. Right. And let's knock him dead.
Yeah. Knock him fucking dead!
Ladies and gentlemen, it's now my great pleasure to introduce the first presentation of the evening, so please give a round of applause.
Sir Alan, ladies and gentlemen, good evening. I said good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Good evening. We welcome you tonight to the presentation of The Wave.
A radical new design. A major development to propel London into a new era. Transforming the skyline forever. Incorporating state-of-the-art office facilities. A luxury boutique hotel. Premium residential living, over 50 floors, with fantastic panoramic views. Giving to the South Bank an iconic and inspiring new concept. Welcome to Wave.
Let's make no bones about it. This is a big project. We are looking to radically change, alter, add to, improve the London skyline forever. We have estimated the total cost of the project to be £730 million. Our mid-range scenario is what we think is most likely to happen, which is a 40% return. It will become a major attraction to all of London's residents and visitors alike, who will come to marvel in wonder at the sheer magnificence, scale, and beauty of The Wave. And we hope you will too. And I'd like to open the floor to questions.
How many icons do you think Central London can accommodate?
Well, as many as is possible, perhaps. I think we've got some in the city. The question is, do we have any in the South Bank? Can you single out any constructions on the southern side of the river that you'd describe as iconic? London Eye?
London Eye?
No, apart from London Eye, I said that already.
As a hotelier, can I just ask, are you satisfied you can get 100 bedrooms out of 64,000 square feet? Because it seems a little tight.
It's a very good question, and it's going to be tight, absolutely. And we're going to have to take the sort of Ian Schrager approach of giving people small boxes to sleep in, but with flashy lights and gizmos and stuff. But, you know, let's make no bones about it. This is a fantastic location. It's a great signature, iconic development, and people are going to want to pay for that, I believe. I believe they will.
Well done. You did very well, Simon.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
If you've said to me, oh, look, there's another day, Christina, have another day, it's your choice. You can go up there on that podium and you can go and do it now, or you can do it in 24 hours' time when you've had a bit more thought. It would kill me to have another 24 hours because I'm ready, and it's as ready as it ever will be.
Ladies and gentlemen, the second presentation.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Phoenix, a truly inspirational building that makes business sense. This building brings regeneration to the South Bank area, bringing new services, stunning residential dwellings and office buildings, and unbelievable commercial opportunities. We decided on this basis that we would commit 64% of this building to residential. We then committed the other 36% to office space. The return in this current environment is excellent. But also, the opportunity that we are giving you today to be part of something like this, a building that makes such an impression, that molds the City of London's future, whilst offering real high quality, both in finish and design. Now I would like you to look at the video and see how it will look today. Thank you very much. Soaring 180 metres above the River Thames, the Phoenix combines iconic architecture with dramatic views, providing a deluxe living and working environment. The Phoenix rises like the mythical bird from the thriving South Bank, ideally located for the City and West End.
507 luxury Riverview apartments, 375,000 square feet of inspirational and flexible office space. The Phoenix has truly risen. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. It's now over to you for questions.
Hello. The return you mentioned, is that per annum? Is that over a 4 or 5 year period? How is it equated?
It's based on 20 years.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Short and sweet. What consideration have you given to the likely tenant profile in the office building?
We're thinking a lot of legal, media, cultural, those, I mean, that's the kind of advertising as well. That's the kind of industries that are in an area like this.
Did your due diligence tell you that those businesses were already located in that area, or are you speculating on that?
I think that we looked at the areas surrounding that area as well as within, although there isn't a huge amount of office space committed to that area at the moment. And that was the feedback that we got from the types of people that would be interested in this building.
Well done.
Thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you.
They're in front of a group of people that spend their lives doing this, are trained to do this, are experienced in doing this, and we're able to speak with real clarity, conviction and eloquence on a very, very complex subject. So I thought they did really, really well. Really impressed.
So if you win this task, we're off to Barcelona.
Rome.
Italy, New York.
Fuck it.
Yeah, New York's better. Exchange rate.
We go to New York. Yeah. Fuck it. We go to New York.
I think as an architect, we have 7 years training and 20 or 30 years experience to get to designing a tower in London. What's amazing is these two teams, have actually done in 5 days this incredible presentation. I think it's exhilarating to sort of see it.
Well, you deserve to win.
Well done. Cheers. Cheers.
You've done a good job, and regardless of this task, everything I saw before I left means that you should be the next apprentice, and here's to that.
Here's to that. Cheers.
I'm not going to.
And if not, you've got a glorious future in property development. So.
Twelve weeks ago, 16 candidates entered this house. Today, the final two are leaving for the last time.
Wouldn't have done a thing different. I think we did a fab presentation. I think that we handled ourselves really, really well. Nothing had changed at all.
I think my strategy has rewarded me no end during the whole process. I mean, I've been happy to play the fool and to be the joker and the village idiot, but beneath the surface of the idiot, you know, is someone quite smart.
At the boardroom, Simon and Christina, joined by the teams they chose to help them, wait.
Hello.
Yeah, Francis, can you send the
people in, please? Thank you.
Yes, Sir Alan. Sir Alan's ready for you now.
Well, a very interesting event last night. First of all, I think I'd like to hear how you felt the team leaders got on. How about Christina? Paul, you've had clashes with Christina in the past?
I think Christina's management style is quite delegatory. She split up the tasks into different chunks and then gave it to people who she felt were best equipped to do those chunks and gave them ownership of that particular bit of the task. So I think that was a very good thing to do.
Bit of a blessing in disguise, wasn't it, Paul?
Oh, I mean, I had a bit of luck there, I think, definitely.
Great luck. Yeah. Adam, what you got to say?
There were times when me and Natalie found ourselves a little bit sort of out of sorts with some of the bits and pieces that we were doing, but overall, the whole thing
out
came
together. Out of sorts? What do you mean by out of sorts?
In any project that you manage, you've got to utilise the members of the team that have got the most experience. We just didn't need any distraction, we just needed to get on with the job in hand and get it done.
Rory?
Yes?
Glad to be back in the fold?
Yes, sir, I'm very, very pleased to be back. Trying to convince you that I wasn't a complete disaster, I think.
How'd you do that, then, with the dancing girls, was it?
I gave you some very exciting shape to start with.
Simon, I think it's fair enough for me to say that it's the type of thing that people are going to love it or they're going to hate it.
You told us to come up with something that would become a legacy, and we've come up with something that there's nothing else in the world like it.
No, certainly nothing else like it. I mean, yeah, I agree. That don't make it good, though, does it? How was your team leader?
He did a very much better job at dealing with Trey than I ever did. So I think, well done to him. Thank you.
And Trey, how about your mate Simon here? Good team leader.
Yeah, no, he was very good. He looks for people's strengths and their weaknesses, and he gives you your task and then gives you the autonomy to get on with it.
Would you have been so complimentary if you hadn't been offered a trip to Barcelona?
What? Where are you going?
I said to the guys, if we were to win this task, I'd take them all away for a weekend.
Why'd you do that?
To replace the
bribery and corruption.
No,
did you not
incentivisation?
In all fairness, Simon, you picked us on merit, and that's why, you know, we would work hard for you. You don't need to, you know, bribe us or put sweets on the table.
Well, as far as the past candidates are concerned, I just want to thank you for coming back and assisting your colleagues here. Would you two kindly step outside at the moment? I'm going to have a chat with Nick and Margaret, and then I'm going to bring you back in, and then one of you is going to get hired. Both very, very employable.
But both very different.
Both different.
My feeling is, I think Simon can see over the horizon, and I don't think Christina can. I think she will slog all day long for you. Will Simon? I'm not sure. I think he'll get distracted. He needs a bigger stage than her. And if you can provide one at his young age, I think he could prove to be a great success to you.
Well, I'm wondering if when he's seeing over the horizon, he's actually going to be paying attention to where he's going at the time. Christina's more focused. Simon's got more ideas. Christina's more mature than Simon. Mm. You could leave her alone more to get on with something. He would need more direction.
Thanks for that, and thanks for the 12 weeks once again. You've been exceptional help. It's down to me now. It's the last two. Thanks a lot for everything. Yeah.
Thanks. Bye.
Hello.
Okay, could you send the two of them in, please?
Yes, yeah, Sir Alan. Sir Alan, we'll see you now.
Well, it's that time, this very, very difficult time for me. You both are very, very employable. You both have different skills. And it's just a very, very tough decision that I've got to make. Christina, why should I hire you?
I think, Sir Alan, I lead from the front. I lead by example. I've got great leadership skills, I've got great business acumen, I'm focused, I'm determined, I so want this as well, which I think is, so important in it. I'm a good decision maker, and you take me into your organisation, and, I'll only just take it forward, that's all. And you will not have to hold my hand or point me in the right direction. I've got the business acumen, I've got the sense, I've got the drive, I've got the skills. You don't need to manage me. I will just work with whatever you give me, and I will bring in the money.
Simon?
I've never attested to be the finished article, and I'm not the finished article. I've still got a lot to learn, and I appreciate that. I'm prepared to work as hard as you want me to work. I will work all day and all night long. I've got an iron backbone that says passion, self-belief, self-determination, force of will and enthusiasm. And I will do whatever you tell me to do, and I will take it on to the next level. And I'll work my cotton socks off for you. I've proved myself financially. I've proved myself I can deal with people, I can give speeches, I can motivate people. I will work my cotton socks off. If you give me something to do, I will go out there and I'll do it, and I'll bring you back twice as much.
It's a tough decision. There's only one job. I've got someone who's very experienced. I've got someone who's enthusiastic, a great talker, willing to learn. And then there's me. Do I need to be the headmaster again? Simon, you're not a good leader of people. And that's something that you will need to work on. And yet, you suddenly surprised me with, very, very good, innovative ideas, very well thought out presentations. Christina, you're a thinker. I don't think you rush into anything. You push hard to clinch a deal, which is what I like. You're a great salesperson. You've brought your child up under difficult circumstances. He's gone off to school. It's Christina time now, as we've discussed before. Simon, there's something also inside me, some devil inside me that says I wouldn't like to let you go either. It's time for me to make a decision, and Simon, do you know what? A bloody old fool as I am, I'm going to take that risk. Simon, you're hired.
Yes!
Thank you, Simon. Thank you so much.
I feel absolutely ecstatic, over the moon to have won. I just can't believe I've come this far, really. It's been an absolute marathon rather than a sprint. To have won, I'm lost for words. I really can't describe how I feel right now. It's amazing. It's just the most wonderful feeling. For me, this is a dream come true in a lot of ways. I mean, I've been aware of Sir Alan since I was about 5 years old, and my dad bought me a computer, an Amstrad computer that I learned to program on. And having won The Apprentice is almost like the wheel coming around full circle.
16 candidates, one job. Sir Alan's search for his apprentice is over.
Congratulations then to Simon, and along with Sir Alan, he'll be joining Adrian Childs to talk about the whole apprentice experience over on BBC Two now.